Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 53. So we're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT no-gov license.
Yes, as always, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT no-government license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
So today, we are feeling the overwhelming absence of Dave the Heel, and in his place is Merrick Van Landingham, who has his own show called Radical Logic on the also on the Seeds of Liberty podcast. So delighted to have him join us. And today
glad
we're
to be here.
Thank you. Thanks for filling in.
This is what I call an upgrade.
I told Dave that I'm going to be brother. Fake Dave tonight. So I'm going to be doing fake Dave.
You forgot the beard.
No, he's clean shaven, and he's not just a head floating in the.
So this is Bizarro Dave then. There's light and there's no facial hair. Yes, we are in Bizarro world with Dave tonight.
Excellent, and so we have as a guest DL Beaven. Who's a voluntarist anarchist and an entrepreneur extraordinaire. And we're going to be talking a little bit about that, how to become financially independent in spite of the state trying to, hamper and strangulate every single person that tries to be, self-reliant. So, DL, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me. I just realized, holy shit, I'm saying what everybody says in that. Has anybody ever been welcomed onto a show and they didn't respond with, well, thank you for having me?
I think we've had a couple of rude people. No, I'm just kidding. Our guests have been wonderful. It's a common response. You can't help it. I think I said the same thing when Danilo invited me on his show the first time. Just one of those responses. You don't even think about it. It's like, oh.
I'm just disappointed. I couldn't come up with anything a little more.
It's okay.
Glad to be here, and taxation is theft.
Yeah, right.
There you go.
I am very happy with all of the taxation is theft memes that I've been seeing. It seems like that's another like Google volunteerism thing that's going on. It's like everyone's focusing on that tech, which is cool.
You better wait to see what I have a new series coming out on that, so this should be fun. Give me a topic to run with, and I'm going to keep going.
Yeah. It's the memes is it's taking over Jeremy's life, which is awesome.
Mostly all I do.
Everybody benefits. So DL, can you tell us a little bit about what you've been up to lately and what you can offer people in terms of, how to achieve, a little more comfort in their lives?
Well, it requires, I think, fundamentally, you have to, it would be a good idea to get comfortable with the idea that it's going to require a lot of effort. It's not something that's going to happen if you are sitting on the couch. If you have a piss poor work ethic, you can expect to fail miserably and consistently. I guess at some point, I don't want to get into a background story just yet, but back in 2014, that was a rough year financially. Even with the nightmare childhood, I think it was probably one of the most stressful, challenging years of my life. And I've always known that at some point I would very likely become an entrepreneur. Because even at a very early age, I recognized that there was the time clock and then there were the people who owned the time clock. And you could punch the time clock and you would make enough to keep up with your bills, maybe. Not always, certainly not in this day and age. Or you could create substantial wealth enough so that you didn't have to worry about punching a time clock. You could have enough money and enough wealth to not have to worry about acquiring wealth anymore. And you could get down to the business of living. I guess I had several, maybe even they were self-imposed obstacles that I had to kind of work through before I could acquire a clear vision of where I wanted to go and how I was going to get there, instead of just having these vague notions of, well, I want to be an entrepreneur, I want to be my own boss. Because, okay, well, what am I going to buy and sell? You know, if you're going to be an entrepreneur, you have to buy and sell something. And the old wisdom comes into play, buy low and sell high. But what to buy and sell? And a lot of people will tell you that you should, well, it's a good idea to play off your interests. Well, a problem that I found was that I have a little bit of interest in a lot of different things, and maybe not enough to make it a passion, which you really kind of need to have as fuel to push you through the dark times where you may not be benefiting from a great deal of results from all your efforts. You're going to have passion to push you through those times. Because fundamentally, I think as human beings, we're wired to want to have some kind of result. You know, generally, we don't want to expend a whole lot of effort unless we're getting some manner of perceived value for the effort that we're putting out. So having a passion, being driven by your passion, can really kind of help out in that regard. But, you know, unfortunately, my passions were such that they didn't really lend themselves to business models that were really anything but niche ideas. And you know, that can be an issue. I mean, if we've already established that being an entrepreneur is good, being your own boss is good, being the master and the owner of your own life, because most people are not, if we've established that those are good things, and okay, so we're going to go into business and we're going to buy low and sell high. Okay, well, what to buy low and sell high? Well, I think if you're lacking in passion in any one particular direction, or you have passion for something that does not have wide appeal, to as a kind of backup option, go for things like food, shelter, transportation, clothing, things that human beings need to exist. So, well, for instance, the pet rock was definitely not a bad idea. It made people rich, but it was a trend. It came and went. Then there's other products and services that are very niche. They appeal to a very narrow, specific demographic. And that requires a very highly tuned method of reaching that audience. And that's not always easy to do, and it's not always it's usually expensive. But if you sell tacos, well, you're going to sell tacos today. You're going to sell tacos 50 years from now. You're
tacos.
Never not going to sell tacos. Everybody loves tacos. If you don't like tacos, you can't be my friend. So what interests do I have that appeal to a wide variety of tastes? And this was a huge thing for me, because I just didn't know. I mean, like I said, I had a little bit of interest in a lot of different things, but not enough interest in a mainstream business model that I felt would really give me the kind of lifestyle that I wanted. What kind of lifestyle did I want? I wanted enough money so I didn't have to goddamn worry about money. I think that's what a lot of people are looking for. So 2014. So yeah, it was an incredibly stressful year. Debts piled on debts. In January of 2015, the better half and I totaled our car. We are currently paying $200 a month as I speak to pay off the balance that the gap insurance did not cover. And that was a devastating blow. And I was working so much. I mean, literally, generally, I don't like to reveal this anymore. And I think I've mentioned it to you guys, but
well, don't worry, nobody else is listening. It's fine. You could just share away.
It's a little too whiny, and I don't like that it puts my focus on a problem rather than a solution. But it's just the truth that for nearly a 2-year period, for about 21 months, I had a total of 17, 18 days off work, which is outrageous. Wow. And I was still going to bed, running the numbers in my head, thinking, I don't know how we're going to pay the rent. And that's, oh my gosh, that's horrible.
Yeah.
It's torture, because it's there when you go to bed, and it's there when you wake up, you yawn, nice new day. Oh my God, I'm fucked. And the knowledge of your situation is so scouring and so profound and so piercing, and there's nothing you can really do about it except endure this grotesque, draconian work schedule. And you know, on some level, I was grateful to be able to work so much that the company that I was working for at the time was willing to pay all that overtime. But believe me when I tell you that every penny of the thousands of dollars in overtime that I earned went to paying bills and debts. And so it was just clear, you know, after this summer, I will have been in the workforce 30 years, 3 decades. I started working in summer of 1986 at 11 years old. And I don't have... I've had nothing to show for all that effort. And at 41 years old, you start realizing, holy shit, I was 25 just last week. 20, you know, 20 years goes by in the blink of an eye.
Yes, it does.
I'm gonna be at when I can't work anymore, when I'm physically unable to do this. You know, that's alarming. That gets your attention. So it was clear that I had to do something. And I adopted a principle. It's not a new principle. It's been adopted by every, on some level, by every entrepreneur that's ever existed in the history of forever. And I call it the SET principle, S-E-T, self-educate, teach. So you acquire knowledge and then share it with an audience. And somebody is going to, you're gonna resonate with people. You're not gonna resonate with everybody, and that's fine. That's to be expected. It's not a bad thing. And so you can begin to build an audience that you can actually begin to create and market content to. And my interest at that time was doing that in a internet marketing capacity. And I had been studying internet marketing. It's really, it's a great business model. I had certain criteria that had to be met with any business that I got involved in because of my circumstances. For instance, I didn't have, you know, $500,000 laying around to pay the fees for a McDonald's franchise. I think that many people don't. There's so many prohibitive barriers to entering in the marketplace, which in my personal view is entirely by design. I don't know if you guys agree with that or not, but it is not easy to become an entrepreneur.
Nope.
So it had to, there, Jeremy, you understand. So it had to be a business model that I could get involved in on a shoestring budget. There had to be a potential for high profit, obviously. It had to be doable, you know, low overhead, low cost of entry. It had to be able to provide me with a high degree of access to leadership and mentorship, because hey, I don't hardly know what the hell I'm doing. Can somebody help me? You know, that's actually, believe it or not, that's tough to find a business model or an opportunity that allows for that, because if you break down $1 million, you know, if somebody tells you, well, yeah, I own a business and I make $1 million a year. That hashes out to a little over $114 an hour, every hour of every day of every week of every month for a year. So we know that wealth is not created by accident. You know, it leaves clues, and there are things that you have to do to acquire it. It doesn't happen by chance. So if somebody is spending their time with you to mentor you and to teach you and to guide you and help you build your business, they're literally spending, and we're talking about somebody who earns $1 million a year, they're spending $114 an hour on a student who may just decide to flake. And of course, they know this. They understand that time is the most valuable primary scarce resource, because it is the resource that we use to build our business, which is the thing that will create for us the lifestyle that we want, which is freedom, you know, the ability to make our own choices. This is what it's all coming down to, is enhancing and increasing our personal freedom, our ability to live free, irrespective of the fucking odious state. That's what it's all about. Getting free, having choices, having options. And, you know, when I started realizing that this was the criteria for my future business, it was almost depressing, because, I mean, how many businesses are going to be able to hit all of those points of criteria, realistically? Not very many. In fact, I knew of none, except perhaps internet marketing. And the drawback with internet marketing, you know, providing goods and services, products online, and I was looking at providing information, educational products online, which I will be delving into at some point in the future once I've gotten some things established. It requires a huge time commitment to get yourself internet marketing is such an expansive field. I mean, there's programming, WordPress, SEO. I could go on and on. Outsourcing, researching the right company to outsource. I mean, it's huge. It is a huge field. And so it requires a lot of time to study, to prepare your business for launch. Okay. So to get out the gate requires a lot of self-educating, and that takes a lot of time, and it can be expensive. But it seemed like about the only thing that I could think of that I could do. And I was able to plug into, you know, there are resources online where it's reasonable to expect that you can get some guidance from some other people who have done it before. There are actually a lot of successful entrepreneurs out there who are marketing and selling products that will actually teach you how to become an internet marketer. And I purchased some of those products, and they're great products, and I would recommend them to anybody. But there's definitely some cost and some time involved getting up and running with that. Fortunately, through a chance series of events, as ridiculous as it might sound, I found my perfect mentor, and I found a business and a business model that I was initially very skeptical about, and I had this kind of transformative moment, this profound moment where my perception just flipped in an instant. And I saw the potential, and I got involved, and I regard it as being one of the best decisions I've ever made in my life. So why entrepreneurship? I think it's safe to say that you guys, I know the same is true for me. I think it's true for a lot of voluntarists. We are proponents of an ideology that is, for many people, fundamentally antithetical to everything that they've been led to believe. And that makes it obviously really difficult to spread these ideas around. which we want to do because we want to make the world a better place for everybody. We want to be free, and we want other people to be free. Well, even if we have concocted the most persuasive of arguments, Jeremy, we were talking about this earlier, we're fighting against people's fears. And a fear, our fears are powerful, fundamental forces in our minds, in our lives, in human behavior. You know, oftentimes somebody who is attempting to rescue another person who's drowning, they're at risk for drowning themselves. The rescuer is at risk for drowning themselves because the person who's drowning is in such a heightened state of panic that without intentionally trying to do so, obviously, they will inadvertently, in trying to save themselves, cause the rescuer to drown. It's happened before, it's documented. So our fears are potentially very destructive things. So that's what we're up against. We're not necessarily, I mean, we're up against the state, but indirectly so. What we're really battling are people's existential fears. Their fears concerning matters of life and death. So we're trying to use clever arguments to convince somebody that jumping off a cliff is a good idea.
Yeah.
And that is not an easy thing to do. I don't care how persuasive your arguments are. So we've got to understand that and get creative. First of all, I think we have to be patient and to an extent emotionally detached from the results. I know I'm not the only voluntarist out there who has seen other voluntarists get incredibly messed up emotionally and psychologically over this whole thing. You know, I can't handle it that the state and people are such sheep and, oh my God, and I'm sick to my stomach and I can't eat and I can't hold anything down. You know, people are getting really screwed up over this.
Yeah, so, well, I call that the angry anarchist stage usually.
Yeah, the angry stage. Sure. I think everybody goes through that.
It tends to hit most people towards the beginning. Or maybe more so what you're describing right there is actually more the burnout stage, because that happens too, for people who get into it for a while and push hard with the activism and stuff. You know, I mean, I've talked about this plenty of times before. You know, it's it affected most of the relationships in my life greatly because I went through that angry stage for the first year, and. Because it's frustrating because, you know, it's not now all of a sudden, you know, the light bulb has gone off for you. You've had that aha moment. You see everything clearly. It's like, you know, I hate to use the overplayed analogy, but it kind of is like that scene, the scene in the first Matrix when Neo finally recognizes it and the Matrix appears to him. You know, it's kind of like that. It's like all of a sudden you see everything. It's like, wow. and then you look to the person next to you. You go, you see that? Do you see that shit? And they just look at you like, what are you talking about, man? And you're like, and you just want to shake, like, again, I mean, I'll speak for myself. Like, I wanted to shake them. I just wanted to shake people. Like, why don't you see this? It's right, like, it's right here. It's not like, it's really not hiding. It's right there.
That's pretty transparent when you look at it with a critical eye.
Yeah. But so, I mean, you know, like I said, I understand that. I understand both aspects of it because I reached an almost burnt out stage after that. And then I had to readjust and reevaluate and realize that, number one, it was killing me. Number two, it was killing all relationships I had, regardless of whether they're ones I really wanted to keep or not. I was just killing everything. And it was not being productive. So I had to flip a switch and go back and reassess and say, okay, what can I do differently? And stop being angry and realizing that, you know, and then I started turning to the other people, the other newcomers, and you know, the people that were coming behind me, or the people that were still in the angry anarchist stage, and going when they yell, you know, oh, you know, why do you bother? These statists are never going to understand. It's like, how long have you been an anarchist? Like, seriously, do you really like forget? Like, that's the problem. People forget. You realize all these things, and you forget that, like, oh yeah, just yesterday, I didn't know any of this crap.
Yeah. So you take the blue pill, or is it the red pill? I can never.
The red. See, you're so funny. Okay, I'm not the only one. Thank you. I said the same. I had the same exact problem the other day, and I got made fun of by like five people. Like, how do you not know it's the red pill?
I don't know.
I only know that because there's a channel called the Red Pill Philosophy. So yeah. Okay. Make that associate. But for me, the that angry stage was directly affected by the Alex Jones. InfoWars, like that fear porn constantly.
That fear porn. That's permanent angry stage right
oh,
there.
Oh man, that's difficult to get out of. And finally, I did. You know, reading some economists, a little bit of Larkin Rose, a little bit of Walter Block, a little bit. You know, you come back to reality. And
Walter
like,
Block.
Walter Block.
Fake libertarian.
Trump, by the way.
Say again.
Walter Block is a fake libertarian. I'm going to say it again. Trump. I'm going to say it every chance I get.
I mean, he writes really good books on economics. I'm not
No,
not talking about
he writes excellent stuff on the topics nobody else wants to touch. He does. He writes like there. Yeah, his next project they're working on the waterway. You know, the privatization
of oceans.
Yeah, exactly. Like that's excellent because nobody's doing that. Great. But the rest of it, he's not a libertarian. He's full of crap. I don't care what Murray said. I don't care what they said. They were wrong in this instance too. They were not gods.
Yeah,
Jesus.
I take a lot of it with a lot of Walter Block.
Sorry, I'm very irate about Walter Block lately.
Well, that's okay. I mean, when it comes to economic issues, fundamentals, first principle type stuff, he's pretty good. I mean, he's got about 500 published scholarly articles.
Oh, he's a very prolific writer. Absolutely. I'm not denying him that.
Anyway.
Sorry, I digress.
I don't worship Tom Woods or Walter Block or Murray Rothbard or any of them. I appreciate what they do, but
right, exactly.
You know, you have to kind of have your own mind. And
right,
if you guys don't mind, if I can expand on Dale what you were talking about, because it really struck a nerve. I've been an entrepreneur in some shape, form, or fashion for most of my life. Started a bunch of businesses. Some have done better than others. Some have failed miserably. But it's a constant state of fear because you don't know what you're doing. You're literally, and I've told my employees this for years, I said, you're going to be a professional bullshit artist because a lot of the times you're going to be winging it. And so you are living in this constant state of just, panic. What am I going to do when this happens or if that happens or how am I going to pay this or... There's so many things, and you have problem employees or, you have an unhappy customer, all these things that go on. And despite the best planning that you can do, things are still going to happen. Things are going to go wrong. So it's best to have a plan of how to deal with it, but just understand that in what you mentioned, you're stepping off of that cliff. And... at least in my case, I'm always putting my own money up. I'm not putting other people's money up. And my wife and my kids live in this house. So I'm putting all of that on the line when we start a business. And if that won't keep you up at night, nothing will. But to go back to what you're talking about achieving that personal freedom, at this point in my life, what I'm doing is I stepped away from my corporate business, if you will. I ran a retail store for a long time in training. I decided to take some time off and think about what I really wanted to do. I read that book by Dan Miller, 48 Days to the Work You Love, if you guys have ever heard of that one.
I know of that book. And
It's great. And it's got a huge Christ-centered bent to it. So if you're Christian, you'll go right along with it. If you're not, maybe not. But regardless, it's still really good. But what I decided to do was take some time and just sit around and think, do some critical thinking about how do I start businesses where I can operate in a more agorist situation and deal with people who are more like-minded. And that led down a lot of paths, but that's kind of what I'm doing. And it sounds like what you're doing as well. It's just trying to, I don't need billions of dollars to be rich. I just need to have the freedom. You talk about freedom. Freedom's internal. And Jeremy, you and I have talked about this in the past. Everybody's trying to externalize their ideas of anarcho-capitalism or anarchism or libertarianism or voluntarism, whatever you want to call it. It's not. It's all internal. It's how you live your life. And that's how I've decided to do it, is to just try to focus more on dealing with guys like you in a business that I'm passionate about. And I can get by on a lot less money than anyone would think and still be just as happy because I'm doing it exactly the way that I want it. And isn't that what we're all after? You know, it doesn't matter if I make bad decisions. Leave it to me to make that damn decision.
Definitely.
And you do. And I've made every mistake in the book in my businesses. I have fucked up worse than you can. It just killed huge deals by saying the wrong thing on a phone call. Because look at me and listen to me. I'm kind of brash. But you have to harness the fear and just not be afraid to go out there and do it. And my thing is, and I'm going to stop talking, but my thing is that never be afraid to try a new idea if you think it's a good idea, with the understanding that if it doesn't work, we're gonna put all our effort into it, we're going to put our money into it, but if it doesn't work, we're never going to be afraid to take it out behind the woodshed and put a bullet in the back of its neck, and then we'll try something different. That's my take.
Nice. Yeah, definitely embrace your mistakes. There is a great book called Go for No. I highly recommend that for any entrepreneur who's involved in any business model. It doesn't matter. Your failures are not truly failures. They are learning experiences, and they are absolutely vital to the process of becoming a master in your business, in your field.
Right.
So if you embrace that process, truly embrace it, and even chase it, chase after failure, chase after that no. It sounds antithetical, it sounds crazy, but you will actually perpetuate your success. So,
you have to learn from your mistakes, right?
That's right, absolutely.
I'm sorry to cut you off, but just to emphasize your point, when you do put a little money behind an idea and you try and it fails, I always call that an advertising expense. We did it. We tried it. It didn't work. But that's just one of the expenses of doing business.
Sure.
Right. Absolutely.
You know? And now I know it cost me, you know, 10 grand, but now I know not to do that shit again. Woo.
Right. So I've noticed that good people were getting just chewed up inside over this endeavor, over our endeavor. And it didn't have to be that way, and it shouldn't be that way. So how can we help? How can we be more free, and how can we help other people be free? And it was a beautiful, happy accident that my mentor got me involved in a business where that is integral, vital to the business model of becoming free. There's a lot of self-development. You have to be willing to step up and become more than what you've been willing to accept about yourself. I really think you have to embrace the notion of delayed gratification. If you're not willing to put a few things off, you're probably going to have a tough time. Saying goes that if you're willing to do for a short while what most people won't do, you can spend the rest of your life what most people can't, by choice, can't do. And I say by choice because we are where we're at in our lives because of our choices. I know we don't want to admit that. We want to blame other people or other situations or other things for our reality. Well, the boss is a jerk, and my wife is blowing the milkman, and this happened to me, and that happened to me, or whatever. And the truth is that, well, yeah, life can drop a shit sandwich on your plate, but you are spectacularly empowered to be able to meet that situation and deal with it in a fashion that allows you to get back in the game and become successful, because there's not that I've ever encountered, and I've got not to impress you guys, I mean, we're talking ultimately about fiat dollars here, and I want to get to that at some point. But I've got guys that I could call right now who earn seven figures a year, amazing human beings. And every single one of them will tell you pretty impressive stories about outrageous defeats that they've had to endure, crushing defeats. So we don't have to take life lying down. We can bob and move and dodge and weave, and we can make, we can, as cheesy as it sounds, we can make lemonade out of those lemons. So you really have to embrace the notion of, okay, I'm going to bust my ass in this endeavor for a short time so that I can spend the rest of my life doing what I want to do, being more free, and helping others to do the same, which I think is an amazing business model. I mean, how does it get better than that? You know, I'm engaging in personal development. I have an amazing mentor. I'm becoming more than what I've ever allowed myself to be while helping people do the same thing.
Pretty gratifying, isn't it?
It is incredibly gratifying. In fact, I was very skeptical and, you know, well, what's the catch? And the catch is that you have to embrace delayed gratification, and you have to have, I prefer really only to work with people who I feel have a stellar work ethic. And I fire people all the time. People who I might otherwise be very willing to associate with in business, they might say or do something, and I'll think, okay, well, for the time being anyway, you're not ready. You're not ready to work with me. I'm not in a sales job. I mean, in a technical sense, yeah, every business buys and sells products, goods, services. But in a traditional sense, I'm not really selling. I'm sorting. I'm looking for people, opportunities that are ready. I'm not trying to strong arm anybody or twist anybody's arm. I don't want to. And if I have to, that's somebody I don't want to work with, because I'm going to have to hold their hand.
You're not using coercion?
And I don't have the time to. Indeed. So I began to recognize that, well, you guys have heard the old saying, the best revenge is living well. Mm-hmm. And what that really means is that living well, which is subjective, it's going to be different for different people. But let's make no mistake about it. And especially if you're a breadwinner, if you've got family who rely on you, having money is important. Having some medium of exchange, whether it's fiat dollars or fish or whatever, having something that you can trade for something that you want more. This is fundamental Austrian econ. I'm not telling you guys anything you don't know. So it's important. And I'm not one of those people that tries to justify poverty. I have people who depend on me for everything, and that weighs heavily on my mind, and I'm not going to let them down. So I believe that we have a responsibility to be wealthy and help other people become wealthy. And a light went off in my mind, and I realized that's, at least for me, that's the winning approach. I don't have to bang my head against people's fears anymore and try to come up with this endless evolution of increasingly witty arguments to justify anarchism.
Just live it.
I can remember. What's that?
I said just live it.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
Teach by example.
That's right. So if it's true that living well is the best revenge, what does this tell us? It means that living well feels good. It feels so good that old resentments and the desire for revenge becomes a moot point, because living well is so good. So if that's true, if that's such a desirable thing, then I don't have to change you from being a dipshit socialist, or as one of my siblings recently proudly proclaimed, a democratic socialist.
Ah, yes. Distinction with a difference, I'm sure.
I never touch the hard stuff. Meanwhile, they're dying of cirrhosis. You know? I only drink beer. All right, buddy. Well, I'll see you at your funeral here in a few months. So anyway, we don't have to engage in this pointless round of self-torture by trying to convince people that they deserve to be free. I can circumvent all of that bullshit and just say, hey, would you like an opportunity that if you got a decent work ethic and you're not going to waste my time, I could help you achieve a higher state of life so that when you wake up in the morning, you're not filled with the same dread and hopelessness that I was for so long. Now you got people's attention.
With the hopes that you can give them the tools to put in their toolbox that hopefully they can grow from what they're learning from you and ultimately be more successful than you are. That's absolutely spreading the message right there. I've had a lot of employees over the years, some better than others, and I've never been afraid to teach my way out of a job. I always wanted to teach whoever was working for me every single thing that I know. Never that fear that they're going to go down the road to my competition and, you know, be a good employee, because if I'm doing my job, they're going to be loyal to me. It's not about the money. That's where employers and entrepreneurs kind of get it wrong sometimes. And not to go all over the board, but it's like this bullshit fight for 15, right? 15 bucks an hour. Well, what if your labor is only worth $5 an hour to me?
Yep.
Right.
All right, so I can pay you $5 an hour, even $2 an hour, or even $0 an hour if you're working for me and getting my knowledge. You talked earlier about time. All right, that's a very valuable commodity to me, as it is to most entrepreneurs, because let's face it, you know, it's like they said about my other business. You know, that people come in, they're like, wow, what a great place. I'm like, yeah, you know, 20 years and overnight success.
But
for the first 10 years of that, I was working 60 hours a week, and that came out to back then was $5.15 an hour. Worked many, many, many hours for less than that.
Sure.
For almost nothing, because you're putting your passion and your labor into your business. You're growing that.
That's right.
And to go back to your talking about work ethic, if you don't have a strong work ethic, you don't need to be an entrepreneur. You need to be a clock puncher.
Go into
the Mackey D's and flip burgers and make fries, and would you like an apple pie with that? And well, you don't have to have ambition.
The irony is that 2-year period of unmitigated torture and stress, I can't believe I'm saying this. Guys, it was so horrible. I almost don't wish it on anybody, but the truth is, my work ethic sucked, and it needed to be completely retooled from the ground up if I was ever going to have a snowball's chance in hell of being a successful entrepreneur. So in hindsight, I have to be grateful for that experience, because it made me what I needed to be so that I could give the world what I needed to give it in order to get what I'm looking to get, if any of that horseshit makes sense.
Well, sure.
So I realized that I didn't have to change people's philosophy necessarily regarding voluntarism versus the state. Just give them a dream and a taste of what they could have if they had a greater degree of freedom and independence, which you could get through entrepreneurship. Now, it is true. I think that it's fair to say most people are not suited to entrepreneurship because they don't have their work ethic dialed in. They're ruled by their fears. They are not willing to embrace the idea of delayed gratification. Guys, as I'm building my business, I'm still working, I kid you not, 60 and 70 hours a week at the JOB, which stands for just over broke.
Mm-hmm.
60 hours on the low end. Now, that's not my business. That's my job.
Mm-hmm.
And initially, I was spending 3 to 5 hours a week building my business. As I'm getting more and more creative and a little bit of success is opening up a little bit more time, I'm getting a little bit more to work with. It's kind of a snowball effect. It gets better. It gets easier as time goes on. But initially, you have to kind of fit it into the cracks and crevices of your life. But the payoff is immense. I was recently, I meet with my mentor who's earned seven figures in our business. I probably meet with him 3, 4, 5 times a week. Fortunately, as luck would have it, he lives in the same city as I do. I'm in West Valley. He's in Draper, Utah, but they're all parts of Salt Lake City, the Salt Lake City Valley. So I have instant access to somebody who's been there. So I have the mentorship part of my equation completely dialed in, which is fantastic because I can go to him with any question or issue and instantly receive leadership and guidance about how I should proceed.
But and that's important.
In fact, it's vital. If you haven't been down the road, it's a dark, scary road. But if you have somebody to guide you, that's absolutely immense. In fact, when it was clear that he was willing to be my mentor, it was such a powerful moment for me. It was also the moment that I realized that this was the business for me, that I went from being a skeptic to being a true believer. It was so powerful that I teared up because I spent a lifetime having a pretty poor self-image. But we're actually going to be meeting in the morning. But I looked across the table at him. I says, "You know what, Dave? I bet there was a moment after you had earned the money and the prestige and the nice things and the nice lifestyle and the freedom from." He wasn't necessarily a time clock puncher. He was previous to becoming an entrepreneur. He was an entrepreneur in a different business. He was a he was involved in stonemasonry contracting and such, but it was the kind of business that you have to be a slave to. And of course, there's a lot of egregious bullshit things that the state does to vampirize your business, egregious taxes and such like that. But I look across the table and I says, I bet there was a time where you realized that it was the friendships and the associations that you've made as an entrepreneur that were more valuable than the money. And he says, yeah, you're absolutely right. And that's when my mission became really so clear, was to kind of spread anarchism by proxy, by helping people become more free. Now, I wanted to get to the fiat dollars idea. I'm certain that there are a great many anarchists out there who bristle at the notion of being involved in any kind of business in a state paradigm, because you know you have a variety of things that require some manner of connection or dalliance with the state. Yes, that sucks. For better or worse, those fiat dollars are right now the medium of exchange. So the idea is to build a business that can begin to give you a greater degree of personal freedom over your life, enhanced ability to take care of your friends and your family. I have a father who lives in southern Utah. He's 65 years old. What if something happened to him? I wouldn't be able to help. That's a terrible feeling. So to help people get more free and then take the wealth that they're starting to earn in their business and direct it into other areas that can provide, that can kind of shore up their position. So in other words, you know, you might be looking into doing some prepping, which that's really difficult to do on a substantial level if you live in poverty. You
know? Yes, it is. It's not cheap.
No, yeah. It's not.
If you can't afford to pay the freaking rent, you know, you're not worried about water or food storage. You're worried about paying the rent. So we can use entrepreneurship, and certain, not all business models are created equal. Okay, let's make that clear. So we can capitalize on certain business models that have, I just made some notes here.
Capitalize.
Oh no. Listen, but, I don't want to start channeling my Beavis, my inner Beavis and Butthead. So
I need TV for my bunghole.
Oh, that's great. We're fucking old. We're
yes,
so sorry.
Yes, we are.
If you were starting to take me seriously, don't.
No worries, man. So there's business models out there that have low startup, low overhead, virtually zero risk. You're plugged into a fantastic system of mentorship and leadership. Huge profit potential with residual income and exponential growth. And for me, that hit it out of the park. That fit what I was looking for with a product and a service that I realized in a huge aha moment was centered on, if you remember earlier, I was talking about selling food, shelter, transportation, mm-hmm. clothing, sex, whatever, things that people need to survive. And another thing that we need is human connection. We need love. We need understanding. Even Grizzly Adams has his pet bear that he's stupidly anthropomorphized. We need to feel a connection with other human beings, the vast majority of us. So the fact that I was involved in a business that is centered in the notion of creating and deepening human connections and love and appreciation for one another was like the cherry on top. And I knew that for me, I had found the ultimate business, and that I get to help other people become free without all of the headache and heartache and hassle of trying to shout down their political misconceptions is amazing.
Isn't that a good feeling?
Oh, it's...
But once you get to that point, at least it has been for me. And not to cut you off, but that's kind of what I do.
It's incredible. There's really nothing like it, because I'm fulfilling what I feel is my purpose as an anarchist, which is to be free and help other people be free. And I'm creating in that person, in the people that I'm trying to help uplift, if they're ready for it. Not most people aren't. That's cool. I'm not a salesperson. I'm not trying to twist anybody's arm. I'm in the sorting business. I'm looking for opportunities and people that are primed and ready to rock. If you're not ready, hey, that's cool. There's 7 billion people and probably infinite opportunities beyond that for my personal growth. I'll be just fine. Check you later. But by helping other people become more financially free, they can actually take that added freedom and withdraw from the state in a way that simple agorism would be very difficult to do for them if they didn't already have some means of financial independence. So it's kind of like a process, a linear process. Let's get some of these goddamn fiat dollars and then parlay that and funnel that into a more agorist lifestyle where we can be more agorist and be more free.
Yeah, and you don't have to make your own soap and stuff.
Well,
is that a Tyler reference?
No. I got what you're saying, though. No, I was just going to say, because I think two people, I don't want to say too many because we're still a very small minority. A lot of people who deal more in agorist, try to live a more agorist lifestyle. Like you, I think you were saying, are like they're like anti everything and anti FR, and I wanted to be like that with my business, but it's kind of difficult. It's difficult enough to start a business and try to start up as like an agorist business where you're going to say off the bat, well, I'm not going to accept these FRNs. I'm going to only accept, precious metals and cryptocurrencies and barter and whatever else I could do that's not FRNs. That's difficult. That's difficult enough. If you have an existing business and you try to go that way, I was in business, over 9 years before I shifted. And started shifting, and it's a slow process because I've had clients who've paid me a certain way for a very long time, and I have I can't just expect them. Number one, I can't just expect them to jump ship and say, oh, okay, I'm just going to pay you this now, especially if they don't deal in it normally. And number two, the other unfortunate thing, which is something has actually come up for me in a couple of recent discussions I've had with people of the more, I guess, statist persuasion, the fact that you know, trying to use that as like the as like, you know, a point of you being a hypocrite for using this money. It's like, well, no, or accepting it. Well, you don't have to accept it. Well, actually, yes, I do. I'm an established business. There's legal tender laws. If
don't
I ref-
throw me in a cage, if I don't.
Yeah, exactly. If I refuse business to anybody solely based on that reason that I don't want to accept that money from them, then yes, they could absolutely try to have me put in a cage for that.
You know, I've heard that argument. That's a total nonsense.
Well, exactly. Most people don't realize that that's the case. They don't understand. Most people, if they're lucky, if they've even heard the term legal tender, but they don't understand what that means. It's like, no, you don't have a choice. If you, especially for somebody like me, like I said, who was already an established business.
Well, look at what the government did to Lysander Spooner when he came out with a better system.
Yeah. Right. They tried.
What happened to the Liberty dollar?
Mm-hmm. Oh God. Oh.
Hey, listen.
That poor guy.
If I am no true Scotsman, I'm perfectly okay with that.
Yeah. No, I got you.
I don't fulfill your definition of what I should be regarding titles such as anarchist or voluntarist, I can live with that. The results that I'm getting are indisputable. They are a matter of historical fact. And I guess, you know, let's keep a running account of who's able to achieve more if this is what we're here to do, which is to be free and perpetuate freedom and help other people be free. Let's keep score. Well, let's check back periodically.
There you go. Like you said earlier, you're doing it by example. You know, just watch. Just sit back and watch.
Well, sure. Because I think the other thing you said too, that the fact that you're not just taking this, you know, this evil money basically is the way they're actually putting it without saying it.
Jeremy, it's the Illuminati money.
Yeah,
Illuminati.
Money. whatever you want to call it. But what you said, that you're not just taking it to like stockpile it. No, you're taking it and shifting it towards these other, you know, these other avenues. Like that's what I do. You know, I take the money that I do in, and you know, I mean, I was very proud last week. I actually finally had my first Bitcoin transaction for my business, which was a big deal for me because I've been offering it as a payment option for 14 months, and somebody finally took me up on it.
Good for you.
But I do the same thing. I take whatever money they, whatever form of money they give me, and I pay what bills I have to pay, and then whatever I can, I start shifting towards, you know, purchasing my precious metals and I try to trade in that more. But the other thing I do, in slowly shifting my business this way, is I'm educating my clients. You know, I do.
There you go.
I preach entrepreneurship to everybody. I think it's one of the most important. It's one of the most important tools anybody can have. I mean, I agree with what both of you said. To the fact that, you know, this isn't for everybody. Absolutely. Now, although I will say, and this is, you know, and sure, it's an anecdotal example, but you know, I took a much different approach than you did to entrepreneurship. I literally fell into what I do. Now, I got lucky because I had, you know, I had family who was willing to back me for the first year. I ended up falling into something that I actually love. Like, you know, I get to hang out with animals all day and stuff like that. So it's really not a bad gig. So I've had it a little bit easier. I didn't have to go through a lot of the struggles. So I think I'm actually a good example too, though, of what can be done for somebody who, because like you, I didn't have the greatest work ethic. You know, I was always good. Like even in school, I had a horrible work ethic. I always did good. I always got good grades, but that's because I was really good at cramming. I was always better when I put pressure on myself. So if I had, you know, the up against the wall, you have to cram for a test, you got to write a report in a night, you know, I aced that stuff. But I had a horrible work ethic. You know, certain jobs, if they interested me, I could get into them and then I would find it. So I knew it was there, but I had to like you said, I had to kind of rebuild that. But I did it kind of backwards because I fell into the business and then realized, oh my gosh, I now have a business. I actually have to figure out what I'm doing here because I got lucky and I got a lot of, I got some clients off the bat before I really got into what, you know, actually being a businessman. And then I kind of had to build it from there. That's why I think the only thing I was going to push, like really the only thing out of everything you said that I had to push back on at all was the fact that, you know, most people, I think you said at one point, you know, most people, it's not really for them. I think more people have it in them. They just don't realize it. And it's the fear and the fear, because for me, like what you're doing, what you're talking about is pushing like entrepreneurship to like get like, not like ridiculously rich. I mean, it's possible that you could, but just to get like, you know, a really good lifestyle. Like that's what you're talking about, right? You're talking about getting like 6-7 figures, stuff like that, like, which is great money.
Escaping what I call the time clock hamster.
Yeah, exactly. I come from the smaller end of it because I'm a small business guy. That's what I have. You know, I have a small business, and I kind of promote entrepreneurship on a smaller level. But it's a lot of the same things, because like you were saying that you have to work. You're still working your job while doing this. You know, that's something. And I was glad to hear you say that, because like I said, I don't have the I don't have the knowledge that you have in this department. Like all my stuff is hands-on experience. Like I've learned this as I've gone. Like I didn't get any training. I had no mentorship. I had a lot of luck, and I did my own research, but not to the extent you did. So I'm kind of flying by the seat of my pants with a lot of stuff that I say to people. It's just, I preface it always by saying, this is just my experience. I'm not promising you anything. But I was glad to hear you say that, because that's the one thing I tell people all the time. It's like, most people think when you say, oh, you know, why don't you become an entrepreneur? Why don't you try to start your own business? Most people seem to think that you have to just give up your job that you have now and jump into this business and it's sink or swim. And it's like, well, no, first of all, that's insane. Why would anybody do that?
No, but second,
well, exactly. But like I said, for me, even on a smaller scale, what you're talking about, I tell people all the time, start it as a hobby. Even if you're not like you were talking about the passion thing. That is obviously one of the most important things. You need to find something that you're passionate about. Because if you're not there, no amount of work ethic is really going to get you past the first 5 years. You're going to want to kill yourself if you're not passionate about it. Even if you succeed, you're going to be miserable. So, you know, you find something you're passionate about. Like, I know so many people that like make little things or you know, they're writers, but they're just not confident. Like whatever, like anything that you could possibly do, any product, service that you could provide that you think would better the lives of people around you, go for it. Find a way. Just to, like I said, even start it as a hobby on the side. Like you said, 3 to 5 hours a week. It doesn't sound like much. It sounds like, oh, that will take forever. Yeah, it might. Or,
but it's part of the learning process.
Well, exactly.
It's part of building your business model.
Yeah, you know, like I said, I'm a kind of rare example, because I fell into it and succeeded really quickly. So, but I also tell people that, like, when people always say, well, how, you know, they can't believe that I've been in this business for now almost 11, you know, I'm in my 11th year now. And it's like, no, I honestly had a lot of luck along the way. I'm not going to lie. I was extremely lucky. Timing was amazing. I got into the market at the perfect time.
You would not have been able to capitalize and extend and maximize if you hadn't had the other things dialed in, if you had a shitty work ethic, that luck would have not carried you very
Oh no, far. Yeah, no, absolutely. Like I said, I had to work on that at the beginning though, you know, so, it's possible.
It's easier when it's your own business. It's easier to be motivated when you're not punching that clock.
Yes. Yes, it is. It is. It definitely is. It's,
you know,
Sorry, go ahead. Oh no, I was just going to say, yeah, I can, even when I don't want to get up most days, it's still, I get up not because I have to, but it's because like, well, no, I've built this, people depend on me. It's what I do, and I actually do enjoy it. You know, like I complain a lot, but that's just what I do. I mean,
yeah, but now it's your reputation.
Well, exactly.
It's everything. It's your legacy.
Well, I don't advertise. I haven't advertised since my second year. So for the last 8 years, I've run on nothing but a word of mouth.
Well, see, that's a good indicator that you're doing it right.
Before I forget, and I can't believe I would have. I mean, this is huge.
It's huge.
Jeremy, Danilo. You guys, we started interacting, it was about September of 2014.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when I heard, you know, about Rothbard and this and that and the other, and had no idea what any of that was about. After about a month or two of kind of taking it in and chewing on it and not entirely initially accepting it, you guys, specifically you two, and a few other guys like Rob Brown. I only know him as Russian Mike. I can't ever tag the fucker on my cell phone. I'm sure there's a way to do it, but I don't know how to do it.
I never could either.
Thank all of you guys. My gratitude, my admiration, my love and respect for you guys is more profound than I can find the words to say. And that's saying something from a wordy cunt like me. I owe my expanded understanding about life, about this whole weird experience that we call life, to you guys directly. And I will be forever in your debt.
Wow. Well, thank you, man.
Pretty,
I mean,
pretty strong.
I must be a better actor than I thought, because back then, man, I was still freaking finding my way. So any help that I gave you might have been blind luck. But thank you, man. I do appreciate that. I you know,
it works.
It well,
I mean,
and I also like how Dave is not mentioned in there.
These are getting serious.
I had to. No. That was just me. Hey, I had to do that.
Hey man, why are you not talking about me? Wait a minute. Roll Tide.
Lisa DeLascio. I hope I'm not butchering her.
Yeah. No, that's right, Lisa.
Rob Brown, Dustin Hutchinson, the Hutch, the man, the guy. Dude's like Godzilla. I mean, he is so inspiring.
Well, you know, he helped me start my podcast.
Really? Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Yep. He's an amazing guy. I mean, you all are. And you've all facilitated a fundamental ideological shift that for me was fundamental to me ending up where I'm at. So right now, for instance, I'm mentoring somebody, a younger guy, and he's already quite grateful to me for having my mentorship, which is weird to be on the other side of that fence. And I don't know if I'll go as far as to say it wouldn't have been possible without you guys, but I really don't see how it would have. The shift that occurred with me after being exposed to you guys and this crazy world of voluntary interaction, what a concept. Absolutely integral to me becoming an entrepreneur, working in a business model that is specifically tuned towards helping other people get free. So I cannot overstate the importance of that event because of the fact that it's an event that's has triggered what is becoming exponential growth with regards to the pursuit of liberty. Capiche?
Capiche.
And if I can expand on that, I love what you're saying, man. Everything you've said over the past hour, I'm just sitting here like a bobblehead doll. Going, yep. And I think a lot of it ties together, and maybe we haven't tied it together, but with these guys helping you, they did so voluntarily. Just like when my mentors helped me when I was first getting started. Why would I go have to reinvent the wheel when the wheel has already been invented? I just need to go to the people who did it and ask them, okay, hey, man, how do you do this? And
that
they helped me.
Was turnkey type business models, but yes, I totally agree.
And that's what you were talking about with your mentor, is that there are people, this is what's called spontaneous order.
Yep.
And then we hit briefly on the fear that prevents a lot of people from becoming entrepreneurs. And I think that if you really want to embrace personal freedom in any shape or name that you want to call it, you need to be your own boss. We talk about not having rulers. Yeah. How about try not having a boss? And sometimes it's not easy. Nobody says it's easy. Like I told you before, I've had a lot of businesses that have failed. But I've had more that have been successful than have failed. But
no, those were successes too, because
they're successes differently, not to my pocketbook, but to my brain. Yeah.
Well, yeah, you need those.
If we're Austrians and we believe in the exchange of value for value, those were, school was in session and you were paying tuition.
That's right. And I did pay tuition several times. And you learn from that. But
you probably have the scars.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, because
we live in the perfect age for doing this. Yes, being liberty-minded is much easier when you have money in the bank. All right? because you can actually afford to live the way that you want. Whereas when you don't, you have to really walk on eggshells and be careful what you say and what you do, because you're always under that heavy hand of your employer to just put the axe to you and say, hey, man, I can't put my business name behind that. All right. Some are more lenient than others.
And somebody who you've helped achieve a higher standard of living through entrepreneurship is going to be a lot more keen to question their formerly held views regarding taxation when that paddle is being applied to their ass.
Oh, absolutely. Everything goes directly through you at this point.
Well,
and
sure.
You say, oh, see, son of a bitch, now do you get it?
Well, that's...
Yeah. All the marketing, all the taxes, all the paperwork, everything that goes along with it.
Well...
And real quick, and then I'm gonna turn the mic over, but you hit on something earlier, DL, that also resonated with me. Why a lot of people aren't cut out, and Jeremy, you even talked about it, why a lot of people are scared or not cut out for becoming entrepreneurs, and I really think it comes down to a couple of basic factors. One is their lack of understanding of basic economics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we could skip the whole 15,000 hours of compulsory government education if we just handed them a copy of Henry Hazlitt's Economics in One Lesson.
Which I was horrible at. I'm proud to proclaim that I think in my entire life, I got one good report card, dropped out by early in the 10th grade, have a terrible record in school. So,
but you're a smart guy. It's the school and education are diametrically opposed, obviously.
Right.
So you've got that. People don't understand economics because it's not taught in government schools. And the other thing is they don't have any personal philosophy. To be able to conquer that fear that, yes, it is dangerous out here being an entrepreneur. Yes, it is 100% up to you whether you live or die. You know, you can starve to death doing this if it doesn't go right.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have a good personal philosophy, this is just my personal philosophy, then it gives you that mental fortitude to say, you know what, I can do this because I understand praxeology. I understand how the human thought process works. So therefore, I can understand how I can do my product, whatever it is. Everything in life that you do, no matter what it is, whether you work for yourself or you work for someone else, everything that you do in life is sales. Okay, everything we do for money is being a professional ass kisser. And for people who get their ego in the way and they can't do that, hey, man, I got nothing for you, playa. You're doing it wrong. This is what we do. We find out, all right, I'm selling this phone here. I need to understand what is it going to take for any of you guys to see this, the value of this. And you need that good core personal philosophy of understanding to be able to do those things. The rest of it is just work, and we can all work. You know, we can put in 16 hours a day. Any schmuckatelli down the road can do that. It's just putting it behind a good idea and being passionate about it. And when I talk about, you know, personal liberty being internal, a lot of this is really the same thing as what I'm talking about.
That's
you know, the love and the energy that I pour into my business is out of greed. It's for me and my family. You know, it's not that I want the $1 million. I mean, I guess I do, but it's because those are my choices.
Rational self-interest, man.
That's my personal liberty.
The greed regarding your desires to increase and improve your position is ex post of the desire to provide value. If it isn't, you're putting the cart before the horse.
That's right.
Your focus should be on providing value to the marketplace. If that is your focus, value tenfold, or who knows, it's
well, of
not
course.
Anything I think.
Yeah, the market will provide.
Well, yeah, because
you'll get value in return. But you mentioned something about people being afraid. Yes, they are afraid. They might have a frightening moment where they realize, holy crap, I'm going to have to, with what I'm doing, there's not really a big time commitment. You have to be consistent, but it's not, you know, we're not talking long work day. My long work days are that's what I do for my job. My business is, you know, I spend really very little time on it, but they realize that it's not going to be, success isn't just going to drop into their lap.
It's uncertainty.
that it is, it's uncertain. They might have to, though you can greatly increase your chances by being consistent and not lazy and applying a good work ethic.
That's right, but it's not guaranteed.
That's right. Yeah, I mean, shit, nothing is. I'll take slim over none any day
that's
of the
right.
week.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's
every, but, you know, one tripping up point for people, I guess, is their own fear and their desire to not they have trouble embracing the notion of delayed gratification. And I did my entire life. I want it fast. I want it now.
Yep.
I'm a sensualist. I'm a hedonist. You know, I want immediate gratification. So that was something that fortunately 2 years of financial hell kind of got, you know, exercised out of me, you know, where I would be willing to finally say uncle and adopt a better way of living. But, you know, one thing that I encounter often, and this is, I don't hold any emotional attachment to the results. I don't hold any grudges. I just make a note that I'm probably interacting with somebody who's not ready, and that's fine. Again, there's 7 billion people on the planet. Opportunities abound. My business will not be made or broken by one association or another if I'm consistent and I'm applying a good work ethic. But oftentimes people will cite the fallacious notion that they don't have time, you know, to do this, that, or the other.
You can always make time.
Well,
that's right. That's right. I'm working 60 and 70 hours a week at my job. I have family. I have friends. I've got other hobbies and interests that I'm currently pursuing that one of them actually takes up nearly as much time as my job. I mean, I don't know very many people, even some of the well, like this past weekend, I was in Phoenix for a business event and got the privilege of hanging out with some incredible, very fabulously wealthy people and mentors who I'm very blessed to be plugged in with. And some of these guys are looking at my situation and saying, geez, if you stay consistent, you're going to surpass me because I didn't have it as rough as you did, you know, with regards to time. But people will say, well, I can't do this or that or whatever because I don't have time. So essentially what they're saying is, you know, I can't grab that life preserver that you've thrown to me because I'm too busy drowning.
It's a good analogy. Well, you know what you call an entrepreneur that works 12 hours a day? Part-time.
Part-time. but, you know, again, fortunately, I found a model where it doesn't require nearly that kind of outrageous time commitment. But that's just a kind of, you know, I'm not twisting anybody's arm. You know, that's not what I do. But I just realized, you know, this person or this opportunity is not ready and it's time to move on. But a lot of people do that and they become, you know, it really is true, as cheesy as it sounds. If you continue doing what you're doing, you can expect the same result. It's not going to change.
Sure.
Your ship is not coming in. Your fucking ship does not exist. Who built it? Who would take the time to build this ship and paint your name on it, you know, in gold leaf and then send it off into your harbor? This is a dangerous idea. No such ship exists.
Liberty is a dangerous idea, either personal liberty or in business.
Well,
to be free to do any of it is dangerous. And I'm not going
to
hijack you again, but...
Yes, you are.
Dangerous from the perspective of the state, you mean?
No, it's dangerous. It's dangerous.
Well,
no,
it's dangerous for your financial situation and everything.
It's
else.
Risky.
For
the state for you to be self-reliant.
Well,
yes.
Well, sure, it's dangerous for the state, but it's dangerous for yourself. It is a risk, but I was just the one thing I just wanted to say because I wanted to say it earlier, but it just came back around again.
This is your show, man.
Yeah, it might be. I thought it was. Hold on a second here. No, just because it came back up again. That's why I think it's not as there is definitely fear involved. A lot of people, like I said, a lot of good people I know are afraid because they, like I said, they either think they have to jump in with both feet, or they're just afraid of the possible failures. But more so, I think a lot of it, because what you both were just describing is more actually laziness. Because the problem is a lot of people talk about personal liberty, but personal liberty is perfectly correlated with personal responsibility. The more responsibility you're willing to take and willing to accept, the more freedom and liberty you can have. And that's the problem. That's the disconnect for most people. Most people don't want to. And it's because they have not only were they not really taught delayed gratification, especially the past several generations, it's getting worse and worse, but the more advanced technology becomes, the less likely they are to actually understand delayed gratification unless it's presented to them in the quote-unquote right context, because why would they? You don't have, like, most people, like, you talk about these ideas, they have everything they want. They have everything they think they want at the touch of a button. Mm-hmm. So why delayed gratification? Are you kidding me? Why would I need to delay anything?
Like,
so
okay, it's Monday. I'm gonna get up. I'm gonna go to work. I'm gonna work hard. Oh, look, a squirrel.
Well, exactly. Well, yeah. Perpetual. Well, that's why one of my favorite memes that I've ever made is the one with the ferrets, because that's really what they are. It's like, ooh, look, shiny object. Ooh, look, shiny object.
Yeah, shiny object. Well, you were making my point that I was agreeing with DL with, is that he talked earlier about it doesn't have to be something huge to get into entrepreneurship. It can be slinging newspapers or, you know, making something.
I started walking dogs.
Yeah, selling it on eBay and stuff. And I've always done that. I've always bought and sold things, you know, cars and equipment and tools, and moved up to houses and properties, and, you know, you just do it. And you can scale that up or down based on what your economic situation is. So, for instance, when I started my property management business, what did it cost me to get into that? Nothing. You know, have some shirts made, business license, some cards, and just go start knocking on doors, you know, hitting the streets, get out on the beach and do it. All right. So we have that has been very organic to bring that up, to the point that now it's a good business. Whereas the one that I'm doing with Manny in Tennessee, Jighead Brewing, is a big operation.
Oh, you know 100.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm working with him setting up the brewery.
I wish he was a part of this tonight. Manny seems like just a wonderful guy. I would love
he
to
is
hang
a
out
wonderful
with that
guy.
Hang out with all you guys. In fact, I plan on being voluntarism's rich uncle. So I've got plans. I mean,
I love that term.
That's good. About all fucking pink ticket, and we just all have this big kind of kumbaya barbecue or whatever. Anyway,
well, that's kind of what we're, I mean, look at what's going on here. That's kind of what's happening, is that we've said multiple times tonight that everybody's helping each other out. This group is how I ended up becoming friends with Manny. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, working on a many hundreds of thousands of dollars project. Nice. And that's how you do it. You know, we didn't,
that.
This was all done completely voluntarily. And I'm talking to and working with other fellow voluntarists. And it can start with nothing. It can start with something really small or something really big, and you can scale it up or down. And just, you, I said I wasn't going to do this, but you guys know me better than that. You just can't be afraid to put, and this is where all of it comes together, because what's the other thing that anarchists like to talk about? Critical thinking. And mm-hmm. we talk about the science behind it, and we have these deep discussions about the trivium and the quadrivium and all of these things, and avoiding logical fallacy. Well, take those tools that you have as a broke-ass libertarian and apply them to your passion. Figure something out. Scale it. Use a good business model. Start it small. Work with people who are like-minded, and then get your ass out there and work 16 hours a day and grow it. I mean, hey, 15 years later, once again, overnight success. But I mean, what's not to love?
Just
people
like
talk
that.
About the American dream. Let me tell you, this bullshit that I see out here is not the American dream. I don't even want to leave my house sometimes anymore. I'm afraid right. The road pirates are going to capture me.
Road pirates. That's make sure you call them that. Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I call them.
My kids know that term very well.
Yeah.
So do mine. To the chagrin of their former cop grandfather.
I've got friends and associates. Friends and associates parroting to me back at me what they hear from me. So what I hear coming back to me is, costumed superhero.
Yep.
Funny right. Costume, shiny badge.
But DL, I think we should wrap up and deliver our final remarks. And I also want to say that I'm not, you know, I don't have the experience that you guys have in entrepreneurship, but I know quite a few entrepreneurs, especially one guy who has he's a chef, he has a food truck for a couple of years, and he's also an anarchist and a homeschooling father. And one thing that he said that kind of caught my attention was that if anybody is more likely to embrace the ideas of anarchism and voluntarism, it's entrepreneurs, because they have firsthand knowledge of how difficult it is to start something from nothing and how easy it is for the state to come in and destroy it with, you know, all the regulations and bureaucratic hoops and taxes that you guys have to comply with in order to be, I guess, on the books, if you're going to do it that way.
That's right.
So yeah, I thought that was an interesting thing. So when he meets with other entrepreneurs, like you don't even have to mention the word anarchy, but you just say, like, God damn these taxes, you know? And everybody, you know, you understand how difficult they make it and how the, you know, the state doesn't help you. They just hinder you. They're putting roadblocks and hurdles and, you know, all to trip you up. And it's almost like, you know, they don't want you to succeed. They don't want you to be productive. And it's a real tragedy that people who are not entrepreneurs, when I talk to them, they still have in this mind that, no, we need the state to help people. well, obviously, you know, you're not dealing with it directly, you know, through a business model, so you don't really see that side of it, right? Maybe you just appreciate the libraries. Oh, the libraries, that's very nice, and the roads, that's very nice.
Well, these are the same people that clock in, clock out, and they just, at the end of the week, they see their paycheck, and then at the end of the year, they're like, I didn't pay any taxes. I got money back.
Right.
You may be missing something here.
Right. So, awesome. So I really appreciate you coming on, DL, and sharing your knowledge and your wisdom in this, because I think a lot of people, you know, especially anarchists and volunteers, are struggling. I think it's important, like you said, Merrick, to live by example, and people will follow that. We can talk with words and explanations and theory and philosophy, but it's another thing just to live by example, and people, you know, pick up on that, and they will follow you. So that's what good leaders do.
I'm going to squeeze this out real quick. Well, I hope that it'll be quick. You guys might have to employ your ninja wizard editing skills to get this condensed down to a length that's going to be, you know, palatable. But I came up with a concept a couple years back that I call the three pillars to liberty. See, I had to raise three fingers so you knew what I was talking about. Anyway, so the first pillar of liberty, and this is all to be able to achieve and enjoy and live a fuller, freer life, free of the state. The first one is physical well-being and health. This is a no-brainer. If getting to the top of a landing of a single flight of stairs leaves you huffing and puffing, you're less free. You're stopped. You're imprisoned by your poor health. So that is a fundamental pillar of liberty. So having good physical health is important. Taking care of your body, eating right, exercising, the whole bit. I'm not telling anybody anything that they don't know. Number two, psychological health. I suppose that you could add spiritual health in with this. I don't delve into that territory. That's, you know, a personal decision. Everybody needs to make that decision for themselves. The point is, is that if you're talking to people who aren't there and you're completely fucking Looney Tunes and you live in a rubber room, you're obviously not free. So having psychological and emotional health is a fundamental pillar of liberty. It's necessary in order to live a free life. And number three, the third pillar of liberty, is financial health. If you live in a state of financial dis-ease, you're going to be far less free than you could be. And that matters. And it especially matters if there's people that depend on you. Because I kind of take a dim view of people who have a poor work ethic, like I did, and who don't take care of their responsibilities. Your life is going to be severely impeded if you lack financial health and financial well-being. So anyway, Danilo, you asked about a website. I don't have a website yet. I'm working on some things and moving absolutely in that direction. For now, anybody who wishes to can contact me and get in touch with me on Facebook, DL Beaven on Facebook. Last name is spelled kind of weird, B-E-A-V-E-N, looks like Beaven. So you can connect with me there. If you have questions about entrepreneurship, if you're looking for maybe a way out of the time clock hamster wheel prison, we might have something to talk about. But that's for now, that's where you're going to want to get a hold of me, is on Facebook. DL Beaven on Facebook.
All right.
Well, I love you guys.
Well,
hey, and one last closing statement, then I'll let you wrap it. Guys, life is not a trial run. This is the real deal. You don't get a do-over. So
right.
If you want liberty, which is inherently dangerous, get off your ass, go out there, leave the cave in the morning, go out, kill something, drag it home, and eat it. All right? Put your freaking Bitcoin where your mouth is and just do it.
Nice.
Well, I almost feel like I shouldn't even say anything after that. But I'm not even going to try to top it. But I don't even think I should speak. I just want to roll credits. But I do just want to take the time to say, DL man, I'm really glad we finally got you on here. This has been a long time in the making. I really do hope that people are some people out there are inspired by you, by your story, and you know, seek you out. And you know, just give it a shot. And and Merrick, of course, man, I appreciate you coming on here with us, upgrading the situation around here. It's always a good thing. unfortunately Dave will probably be back next week, but just kidding, Dave, I do love you.
I told him he's been fired.
He's been replaced. Actually, you probably shouldn't tell him that. He'll actually probably be happy. One thing Dave loves to do is advocate responsibility. Big fan of it. So, thank you guys so much. This has been great, and hopefully we get to do that Kumbaya barbecue one day.
Check out jigheadbrewing.com.
Absolutely.
I would love that, and I've got to hook up with Manny, like, in real life. That guy just seems like he would be such a blast to hang out with. But I'm going to leave you and everybody else out there with something that took me decades to get prepared to internalize and to put into action, and so I'll share it with you. It's valuable if you're ready and willing to put it into action, and that is this. Acquire a plan. Doesn't matter where you get it, as long as you didn't use violence or coercion. Acquire a plan for positive change and implement it with relentless persistence. Get off the goddamn couch. Turn off the Nintendo for a little while and put that plan into action. If you don't have one, get one. Find a mentor. Scour the earth. Get determined. If you flip that switch and you become determined to the degree that you're simply not willing to accept defeat, you will find the way that is appropriate for you, and you will get the prize.
Awesome.
Gonna get a hell yeah.
Well, thank you very much, gentlemen. Wonderful conversation. Thanks, DL. Guys. Thanks, Mary, for coming on. I really appreciate seeing a clean-shaven man for once.
Thanks, Danilo. I appreciate being on. It's always fun.
I'm always the only clean shaven. Well, Jeremy sometimes.
Not lately. I'm just too lazy.
Back and forth.
Yeah. But awesome conversation, gentlemen. Thank you very much. So if anyone wants to help us out, you can do so through Bitcoin or Patreon as patreon.com/seeds of liberty.
I was only putting $1 a month into it because that's all I could afford to give. But things are a little better now, so I bumped it up to $25 a month. I know I'm a big spender. I know.
You rock, DL. Thank you, man.
That's awesome.
But I always say, but just like, comment, and share. That means a lot. That means more to me. So, try to spread the message.
Sweet.
Spread the message, please. Thank you very much. Awesome conversation. So this is the Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.
Peace.
Peace.